Hey, thanks for joining us here at Hanging Out with K-Dubs Podcast. Tell us how we're doing, or maybe be in a future podcast episode. Hit us up at hangingoutwithkdubs@gmail.com. Up next, the latest episode. Thanks for listening. Well, I mean, I feel that you have to have a beverage every once in a while.
It's pretty mandatory.
Especially with something like this.
Yeah.
You and I, we don't see each other that much.
No.
So,
no,
you know.
It's good reason to get together and have a drink and hang out for a little bit. And
talk shit.
Absolutely. That's about it.
So, what do you do exactly?
As far as work?
Yeah.
Commercial, for the most part, commercial sheet metal worker. So, any sort of heating and air, you know, big buildings, anything from strip malls to the one I'm working on right now. 600,000 square foot building in Dixon.
Holy shit.
Yeah, the units, the makeup air units that we're putting in, they're 16,000 pounds a piece.
Oh my God.
The ductwork, I got a, Hunter sent me a picture. I was standing inside one of the pieces, sealing it from the inside. The ductwork's 8 foot tall by just under 8 foot wide.
So that's where the heat and everything goes through?
That's where the air channels through. Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
That's huge.
Normal, like in your house here, the biggest ductwork is probably 18 by 12.
Yeah, it's not very big.
No, no.
And especially in a small house like this.
Yeah.
You know.
And yeah, in that building down there, it's the biggest duct, some of the biggest ductwork that Hartwig Mechanical's ever done.
Jeez.
And I'm
so when you seal that, are you welding it?
No, well, sometimes. Anything that has to do with, basically, if it transfers like grease fumes from a kitchen or anything like that, it is welded black iron, so it's a heavier gauge steel, welded flanges, you know, the whole nine yards. But this, it has a like a quarter-inch thick butyl gasket that goes around the outer flange, and then it's a companion flange, so it bolts together. So I was inside there, and I was getting everything, all the corners sealed up and whatnot, and then basically we lift it up in the air with a big either telehandler or forklift or chain falls and, you know, bolt it together in the air and hang it and support it. And
that's crazy.
It's wild. It's cool. It's cool. Every day is different, you know.
And you said that's the biggest stuff that you've done?
Biggest stuff I've done, and it's right up at the top of probably the biggest stuff that our shop has done.
So do you guys use, like, cranes, forklifts for all that stuff?
Yeah. All the stuff outside, like these big units that are coming, they're going to all be set with cranes. Say you go to a Walmart, for example, any of the rooftops that are up on the roof there to heat and cool those buildings, that's all cranes. And actually the pedigree building in town, they set all those with a helicopter.
No kidding.
Yeah.
That's cool.
They had a helicopter come out, and I think there was like 30 some units that had to go on the roof for that building. And I think it was Altoff that was doing it. And I was sitting on my mom and dad's porch out there, and this chopper comes flying over and he hovers over the building. I'm like, what the hell's going on? So I looked over there and picking units and setting them up on the roof. And it was cool. I've yet to do a helicopter pick. The shop's done a couple of them, but those are wild.
I'm sure that's real cheap.
Yeah. That's the reason that we don't do a whole lot of them.
I can believe that. So you said that was 600,000 square feet?
The one that I'm at right now, yeah.
And that's all heated?
All heated. And cooled.
And cooled.
It's a heated and cooled factory. So them factory workers, they got it made there. It's, it'll be fine. It's a Rainer garage door. So the big garage door company,
mm-hmm.
they just got this building down in Dixon, and we're going through and remodeling it. It used to be a Rayovac factory for batteries.
No kidding.
Yeah, and then Rainer bought it, and now we're basically building it to suit their needs.
So how long does something like that take?
On our side of things, I've been down there for about a month and a half, and I'll be there until probably, I would guess, end of January, we'll be out of there. Our pipe fitters, though, running air lines, water lines, gas lines,
all
that.
Oh, that's going to take forever.
They started in, I believe it was July, is what the foreman, the pipe fitter foreman down there said. And I think they're going to be down there until probably June.
So that's almost a year project for them.
Yeah, yeah.
But for you guys, it's three-ish months.
Yeah, it's not bad. We're in and out pretty quick. That's another reason that I like doing the sheet metal is just the fact of you know, it's we're not stuck at the same place every day for years on end. You know, it's every couple months or so it's different. And you're doing different things, going different places. And I mean, hell, last winter I was stuck in Joliet for 6 months. Every day.
Joliet?
Every day. Every day.
That's a bit of a haul
from here. 5.5 months. Yeah, it was like 104 miles one way.
It's about 2 hours, isn't it?
Pretty close.
With traffic
and
everything.
Yeah, in the mornings it was like 1 hour and 45 I could make it in. On the way home it was 2 hours, 15 minutes about.
Oh.
Yeah.
F that.
Yeah, starting at 6 in the morning. Yeah.
Yeah, that makes a long day.
It makes a really long
travel
day.
Time from work. You know, whether it's you're 20 minutes away, an hour away, or 2 hours away.
Yeah.
That totally adds to your day.
Oh, absolutely.
Shortens it.
Absolutely. It's big time because, I mean, you look at it, it was basically 2 hours each way. So half of your working day, you're spending that extra time driving.
In the car.
In the car. I was filling up the work van every morning.
Jeez.
Every morning. I could make it, so I fill up. In Marengo at the corner 23 and 76 at that little gas station there.
Yep.
I'd fill up there in the morning. By the time I came back around and went past there the following morning at 4:15, filling up again. And that's when gas prices were $5 a gallon.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's got to hurt the old pocketbook a little bit.
Yeah. I mean, luckily, they got me in a company vehicle, so.
Yeah. For you.
For me. For me.
So how far have you traveled for the work then?
Furthest I've gone for work is we were just east of Indianapolis, and it was like a two-day gig out there to Walmart. So it was kind of get in, get out, get done.
So you were down there for 2 days. You didn't come home back
no,
and forth, did you?
No, we went down, if I remember right, we left on a Wednesday night after work. So basically we worked all day Wednesday, and then I met up with the foreman that I was working with after work. And
makes
we
sense.
Took off and headed out to where we were staying and stayed there overnight. We got everything that was supposed to get done in 2 days done in 1 day, and then we trucked it home that night. So it was pretty much almost 3 days straight of running to get it done. But
yeah, but
bad.
It's done.
It was done.
And you were home.
Yes.
You know.
Yes.
That next night.
Yeah. And
it's not like you were away at that point.
Yeah. At the same time that we were doing that, we had another crew of guys that were up, I want to say they were just outside of Cincinnati, maybe, or somewhere up around
oh,
there.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, in Ohio.
That's quite a
in
haul.
In Ohio, yeah.
So you guys go 4 hours in any direction then, huh?
Yeah.
Pretty well.
Yeah, we had one of our foremen that lives in Gilbert's, he was doing a job in Merrillville, Indiana, which is right across the border, which for him was 2 hours. So from home base, from the shop, it was like a 3-hour drive just to get
oh,
there.
Oh, man.
Yeah, he was down there. I think he was down at that one for 4 or 5 months.
That's a...
Yeah.
That sucks.
Yeah.
But you got to pay the bills, too.
You got to pay the
and
bills.
And if you're good at your job,
yep.
you don't do it for free.
Right.
You know?
Absolutely.
At least that's what I've always been told.
Absolutely. So, and that's the other thing, too. I mean, they say, you know, if you like what you do, you don't work a day in your life. I'm to the point, I enjoy what I do. I wouldn't say I like it. I mean, nobody likes working. Who likes working, you know? But
I just had that conversation today at work.
Yeah.
I'm like, no one likes working.
No.
But
you find
we have to.
Yeah, you find something that you're good at. You find something that clicks, you know? And I mean, back in school, I was never a math wizard at all. That was probably my worst subject. Well, ever since getting in the field and actually putting math into a real-life perspective.
Yeah, that makes a huge difference.
That's the fun part of the job now. And that's the worst part. I hated math. That's the fun part of the job now is trying
yeah.
to figure out how to get from A to B. And
you know. And then I'm sure you got to cut it all down to size
yep.
and make sure it fits in this specific spot
yeah.
and blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
You know, so you have to use that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's every day. I mean, I've still never used, like, A squared plus B squared equals C squared. But.
Yeah. I mean, the whole Algebra 2
yeah,
thing?
Yeah, no. Uh-uh.
Yeah.
It was
But
it was
to
rough.
Find the answer to A or B or whatever, we've all used that.
Yeah. Yeah, and you got to go around about ways to get to where you need to be. And, I mean, we're talking measuring within an eighth of an inch over 120 feet. So it's like
pretty precise
down to the brass tacks when you get to it to measure it out. Because basically we go in and it's an open, wide open building. It's all bare. And
so do you have layouts then on where your ductwork supposed to be?
Yeah, we have blueprints that we go off of, and, you know, we try and keep it as close as possible to the actual drawings. I mean, occasionally you'll have sprinkler lines or gas lines in the way that you got to divert one way or the other. But we go into just an empty building with no trucks coming with any material or anything. And as the foreman, your responsibility is basically to keep your journeymen or your apprentices that you have with you busy, to keep them working so they can pay their bills as well. So we'll go in and basically bigger jobs, you'll spend probably a week on your own as a foreman going in, getting material lists together, getting, you know, all the material to hang the ductwork and getting just the straight ductwork, getting that listed out so they can deliver it. Okay. And then when it gets down to the detailing part of it, you know, getting from A to B and changing elevations and changing directions, then you go back in and you have to actually, like, draw up listing tickets with the fittings on them, the sizes you need, the offsets you need. There's a lot that goes into it.
Yeah.
Like, on an average day, on a really well-working job site, it's probably 2 to 3 hours of my day is just paperwork and listing.
Oh, I can believe that.
Yeah. And then, I mean, it's still fun to put the tools on towards the end of the day, but... it's cool. It's challenging, though. I like it.
So, like, this job site you're at now, how many feet of ductwork do you guys have to build or
this
put
one,
into place?
So the reason that we're kind of in and out pretty quick on this one is these big air handlers, they sit outside the building.
On the ground,
on pads, on big, I mean, concrete pads the size of a 3-car garage is what they poured for them, basically.
Oh, shit.
And the ductwork that's coming out, like I was saying, it's like 8 foot by 8 foot is what some of it is. It comes into the building and it ducts up pretty well close to the ceiling and then turns out, and then it just gets a big, like a blast diffuser on it. So the air just disperses from there, and there's so much force from these makeup air units that you don't need to duct it all the way across the building and then run your what you would normally run would be rounds. You would run your rounds out and then they'd come down to a grill to where it would disperse the air. Well,
so they're straight fairly well after you go up and
pretty much
turn them to a 90
and these
straight.
Yeah, and these ones that we got, I mean, they have so much force behind them that they don't need any ductwork past the 90 pretty much. I mean, it's just this big blast cap on the end of it, and it,
no kidding.
Yeah,
so there's no ductwork like across the ceiling to dump in the middle of the place?
No, not really. Oh, there's a couple of existing air handlers that are on the roof, and they duck down into the building, and they just come down into, we call them concentric drops, but it's basically a piece of duct that comes down and it kicks out the direction that they want it blowing.
Okay.
And that's
fair
it.
Enough.
And that's it. That's all there is to it. And the office areas, there's a couple offices, and those have, you know, the normal full duct system. Like if you were doing it in a house or
yeah,
something.
Yeah, right.
They got the full systems in there and whatnot. But yeah, these big units, I mean, they don't have hardly any ductwork on them.
That is insane.
Yeah, it's cool. It's really cool. It's a different experience. This for me, from what I've ran of work so far, this is the biggest material and equipment that I've got to deal with.
Well, and I'm sure the way your business is growing, I'm sure it's only going to go up from there.
Yeah, it's wild. I mean, the last year and a half it's been a ride for sure, but it's in an upward trend right now. So,
well, that's a good thing.
Yeah.
You always want the business you work for
to do good.
An upward trend.
To do good.
You know, because you want to collect a paycheck.
That's,
you know,
that's the thing. That's what I always say is, because, I mean, you get some of these guys that come into work and, you know, they try harder not to work than just to do their job. And what I don't understand is people's perspective, because the way that I look at it, if Hartwig's making money, John's making money.
You're making money.
John's making money. So why would I go to work to try and not make them any money? You know,
I totally agree.
That's my goal on it.
The only way that doesn't work is if it's government.
That's true.
Because there's always money coming in.
That's true.
You know, people paying their taxes. So the government can be, not efficient.
Yeah.
And
absolutely.
Be perfectly fine. You know, where if you're a business and you're counting on people to do their job to make you money.
Yeah.
That's huge.
Yeah.
That's when you have to be efficient. You have to have good workers. You have to pay them well. You have to make sure they're happy to make sure that that money's still flowing every week.
Yeah, because they, you know, I mean, it basically, and the way that it's been portrayed to me too, and I obviously see it the same way that it's been portrayed, but when it comes to the business side of what we do, the guys in the office are the ones in charge of the ship. But when it comes down to it, the guys in the field are the ones that are the face of the company.
Absolutely.
So it's, you can't, you know, everyone makes it out. You go onto a job site and everyone there is an asshole and everyone there, you know, just a bunch of dickheads and whatnot. We are to a point, but to another certain point, I mean, you got to look at it as we are the face of the company we work for.
No doubt. Yeah, the managers are there to make sure that you guys are all in the right place.
Yeah.
Your foremans are there to make sure you're doing your job
sure
the most efficient way possible.
Yep.
And then it's your job to bust your ass and make sure that you don't let your foreman down.
Yep, absolutely. That's all we're there for, is just to keep the ants moving.
The only difference is when you move up in the world, all of a sudden, John, you become foreman. Now, all of a sudden, you can say, hey, I've been in your shoes.
I am foreman.
Oh, are you?
Yeah, I have been for like a year or 2 years now.
Well, good for you.
Thanks.
I didn't know.
But yeah, no, it's...
Dude, you're a foreman at a young age.
So the apprenticeship was 5 years. I started right when I got out of high school. The day of our senior tribute, I had to leave early to go take the aptitude test for local 265. And I went down, did that, tested. Before I got home from Carroll Stream, I had the phone call saying, hey, you passed with flying colors. You can start whenever. So I called my dad right away. I'm like, hey, and said, I passed. When do you want me to start? He's like, well, you're going up to Canada for a week with your grandpa fishing, right? I'm like, yeah. He's like, all right, you get back on a Sunday? Said, yep. He's like, okay, that Monday. You're starting. And that's it for the last 7 years. That's all it's been. So I did the 5-year apprenticeship, graduated that, and within 2 months I was running work, not as a foreman, but just, you know, running work, taking over small jobs and making sure they get finished out and whatnot. And then I did that for about 6 months, where I was just running work as like a lead guy. And then in March of 2020, I want to say it was March of 20 or March of 21, maybe, that's when they put me into the van and actually promoted me to a foreman.
Okay, so because you brought up 21,
mm-hmm.
How did COVID affect you guys? Or did it?
Dude, COVID was great for us. COVID was great for us.
No shit.
Yeah. Look at it this way. All those big office buildings down in Chicago and in the suburbs.
Nobody was there.
Sat vacant. So all that maintenance work that's been getting pushed off because of the fact
Brilliant.
That there's been people in there and you can't get in for certain times and this and that.
Mm-hmm.
All that maintenance work got done. It was COVID was.
You probably ran your ass off.
Oh, dude, it was awesome though. It was great. Some job sites, yeah, it messed them up pretty good. I mean, like, the stupid mask restrictions and everything else. Like, they expect you to work with your work partner but be 6 feet apart.
That don't work that way.
How do you hang a 5-foot piece of duck when you're 6 foot apart from each other, Kyle?
John, you got to become the Hulk.
You
got to just put it up there yourself.
That's pretty much it, yeah. So there was, I mean, there were the hoops to jump through, but God damn it, we were so busy. It was awesome. And, I mean, ever since then, we've been consistent, too. We've been pretty steady.
Good.
But otherwise, yeah, it was great. It was great. Getting to work was easy. There was no one on the road.
Oh, man.
No one on the road. I mean, everything. Getting in and out of the city. I didn't mind working in the city because you can get in and out like it's nothing.
Yeah, I didn't even think about that. I just thought maybe they just shut you guys out completely,
nope.
You know, and said, nah, we're not going to do this.
Nope. We were essential.
Well, I mean, there's a lot of businesses out there that were
essential,
you know. But, I just didn't know how that would work.
Yeah.
I mean, I figured emergency stuff, you guys would be able to get in. But to go in and redo everything, that's good.
Yeah, it was really good. We did very well during the whole COVID spree. So it was... I mean, like it was for anyone. At the beginning, it was nerve-wracking. You know, the first job site that we were on when that COVID shit started, we were down there working. It was at a Target in Chicago. And we were down there working, and it had been, you know, masks and hand sanitizers and this and that, and whole 9 yards.
You know, at first.
We didn't know.
No, I mean, you think back to March of 2020, you know, oh, this new virus is coming out of Wuhan, and we were all a little bit like, okay, hey, what's going on here?
Oh, there's,
you know, and then, you know, you fast forward into April, and it was here, and everybody was like, oh, we're losing our minds, you know. But then you fast forward a year, and it's like, okay, I understand now.
Fast forward 2 years. Look where we're at right now. Where'd it go? You don't hear about it anymore, you know.
It's gone.
Poof.
a magic trick. Put it in the hat.
Yeah, that's it. Just disappeared. Stuff it away for the next time you need it. But, yeah, no, it was. The first, like I was saying, the first job site that we were on when it made it to the Chicagoland area, one of the electricians on there tested positive. And we got a big call and a big email went out, and it was this big deal. Like, look, you guys all need to go get tested. You all need to, you know, figure this out, make sure you're fine or whatever. And I sat down and had a conversation with the foreman I was working with. I'm like, dude, what happens if we get this? Because, like I said, it was right at the beginning. It's like, oh, 90% of people that get it are dying. I'm like, great, there goes my life. But come to find out,
it's not as deadly as they said. The funny thing is where I worked at that time, I was the first one to get COVID out of the entire place.
Really?
Oh, yeah. So one day I came in and I just – feeling like dog shit, you know, and just feeling like crap. So I just told the boss, said, hey, I'm gonna go home. I don't feel good.
Yeah.
He goes, well, yeah, maybe you got COVID. I'm like, I ain't got COVID, you know. I went home, and it progressively got worse.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I better go get tested. So I went and got tested, came back positive. So I called the boss and said, hey, sorry, I got it. And I guess they had a huge meeting. They brought everybody in. Of course, you know, this isn't a huge company.
Right.
I think where I worked at, there was like 17 or 18 employees. Mm-hmm. So we all knew each other. And the owner, GM, whatever you want to call him, was like, somebody came down with COVID. You all need to be careful. But we can't tell you who it is. And I'm the only one that's missing.
Yeah, you're the only one that's not at work, right?
Exactly. So everybody's like,
yeah, Kyle's got diarrhea.
Yeah, I get a text message, you know, like, you doing all right, dude? I'll live, you know.
Yeah.
But, you know, back then, we just didn't know, you know. And then as we've progressively gone along here, you know, we've realized that it's a virus that affects a lot of people differently.
Oh, yeah, 100%. 100%.
So it was just funny, how that whole thing worked out, you know, at least in my opinion.
Yeah, yeah. No, I don't know. I just hope that this shit's over with, you know.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I'm going on vacation this winter.
Okay.
And where I'm going, it's down south, mm-hmm. like past Florida.
Yeah.
You know, and there's no restrictions whatsoever. So we're getting close to being back to where we were as far as the freedoms go.
Yeah.
You know. As far as money goes, everything's
Dude, it's ridiculous.
You know,
it's
this inflation
ridiculous.
Is...
I can't go to the grocery store and get a week's worth of groceries for under $250.
I go myself, and it's just like I blow $150 on myself.
Like it's nothing.
You know?
Yeah.
And it's 10 days.
Yeah, exactly. You know? It's ridiculous.
I might as well go to freaking McDonald's at $10 a meal. You know? It's the same thing.
Right. Right. That's.
I mean, it's not. You know,
it's not, but it is price-wise. I mean, price-wise. When you break it down, it's just as expensive to go to the store and buy groceries as it is to either, you know.
Where do you shop for groceries?
Most of the time when I shop.
Okay.
Walmart.
Where does the other half shop?
Beck shops all over the place. Currently, right now, she's working for Instacart, which is like a grocery delivery. It's like Uber for groceries.
Oh, no shit.
So you put in your order or what you
Wait,
want.
What's it called?
Instacart.
Instacart.
Yeah. So you put in your order for groceries and what store you want it picked up from. And it's basically a big pool that all this goes into, and whoever accepts it first gets it. They go and shop at the store for you, and then they deliver your groceries, and you get paid to do
I've
it.
I've never even heard of this.
You get paid to go shopping for people now. Instead of these people, I get it. She says most of her customers are like a, you know, some sort of an elderly clientele for the most part.
Well, absolutely. I mean,
there's a lot of able-bodied younger adults
that say, fuck it, I don't want to go shopping.
They're paying stupid amounts for it. Like some of these orders, because the bigger the order, the more she gets paid for it.
Well, that makes sense because you're spending longer in the store.
Right.
So
and some of these,
getting paid, you know.
Yeah, some of these orders are going, like on average, they're like 5 miles from the store. And she's getting like $20 to $25 an order to deliver them. So you're paying an extra $20 to $25 for groceries because you don't want to drive 10 minutes up the road and go get them?
I mean, that's something, you know.
I'm not
And
saying.
She can do it with the kid.
Yeah, oh, yeah, absolutely. She can take Wyatt with him. And, you know, I mean, she's even
So what does she do then? Just drop it off at the doorstep? here's your
phone. Pretty much, yeah. There's like a little, there's like a messaging section in the app or whatever, and she messaged him like, hey, you know, leaving the store now.
What's the name of that again?
Instacart.
Instacart.
Yep.
Dude, that is cool.
Yeah, she delivered to someone right up on White Oaks the other night on her way home. So she was driving home from McHenry, because it's pretty busy over there. So that's where she does most of her stuff, is Woodstock, McHenry. And she was driving home from McHenry and got an order that popped up from Harvard, I believe it was Walgreens, and it was going out to White Oaks Road. And she's like, okay.
That's a no-brainer.
It's on the way home, and it was like 5 items or something like that. So she, I mean, from Walgreens to White Oaks, she's getting paid to drive there. I'm like, all right, cool.
Sweet.
So, yeah. No, it's wild though. Some of the shit that they got out there now. I mean,
oh, I know. It's some of these apps and stuff that they make. It's cool as hell.
Yeah.
You know, I'm in the middle of trying to get my CDL.
Okay.
You know how many apps they have for CDLs?
For like training on them?
Yeah, like taking the tests.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like they got practice tests, real tests, all the answers to the questions that they ask. I mean, blah 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 blah, all the way down the line. You know. It's really helping me out.
Pretty soon it'll be a video game to pass the driving test.
Well, I mean, they have aviation games and stuff like that where you can learn to become a pilot based on the aviation games. I don't see that being too far off in the future.
Right.
You know?
Dude, it's wild, man.
This technology is it's increasing and going further every day.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be interesting in 100 – I won't be here. But in 100 years, it's going to be interesting.
Don't even take it to 100 years. Look at how far technology's come in 20 years.
Oh, I know.
Go 20 years from now.
I know.
There's going to be like the Jetsons out there.
It's going to be fun.
Yeah.
It's going to be a fun ride. As long as you understand what technology is, you know. I mean, the older generation from us, you know, there's a lot of them that are like,
what's an iPad?
I got to download an app?
Yeah, what's an
what's
app?
That?
What's an app?
You know?
An appetizer?
I
got
to sign in to Netflix?
Yeah.
I ain't watching it.
Yeah.
You know?
Absolutely. Where's the DVD? Where's the VHS is at? But
the funny thing is like, my parents still have a whole thing of VHS tapes.
No kidding.
How they do.
No kidding.
Yeah. I don't even know what they got in there anymore. A bunch of Disney movies. I'm sure they're worth a button.
Oh,
you know,
dude, some of them are going crazy. I think my parents might still have a milk crate full of the old Disney VHSs from when I was a kid. I remember I had the whole box set of the Dukes of Hazzard on VHS, and then the DVDs came out and they're like, oh, this is the latest and greatest. So then I got the whole
box because,
set of,
you know,
Dukes of Hazzard.
They updated all the visuals
and made it look better. And oh yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah. So I still believe still to this day I have the whole
and
box.
And Daisy,
set.
You know.
Catherine Bach, man. Oh, what a dime.
Yeah,
I think she's probably the first time that at a young age I looked at a woman and went, yeah, I don't like wiener. Daisy Duke, man. I looked at her and, you know, Duke's Hazard was on. I'm like,
that looks like fun.
Yeah, women are where it's at.
Yeah, they, we got it easy, us men.
Oh yeah, big time.
Yeah, compared to women, we got it easy.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, the problem is society says that they need to wear makeup and they need to be a certain figure, and which is bullshit.
That's why. But, I'm lucky I found one that doesn't need any of that shit.
Yeah,
you know?
I mean, mine either.
Yeah,
I mean,
it's the best. It's the best. I mean, they look, do they look pretty good with it on? Oh, yeah. But do they need it? No way.
No.
No way.
No way.
Uh-uh.
And I'm not a big makeup guy anyway.
No. Too.
I don't care if she ever wears makeup ever again.
Yeah.
It wouldn't bother me a bit.
Yeah.
You know, I just always thought that too much makeup.
Oh, you look like a cartoon.
What are you hiding?
You look like a cartoon.
What are you hiding?
That's why they say nowadays, if you take a chick on a first date, go swimming.
That is a good one. Yep. I haven't heard that yet.
Yep. You take a chick on a first date, go swimming. Two reasons. Two reasons. The makeup and then, you know, the nether regions. Because so. You never know, Kyle.
That's true. In today's world, you never know.
Dude, it...
People cannot be anything they want to be in this world.
Right.
Especially kids. I mean, I think you were told that when you were a kid, you can be anything you want. Bullshit.
I'll never be an NBA star.
not too late.
Even if I wanted to be, I still couldn't.
Work on those jumps.
Yeah, right. Me and Hunter were just doing that today. There was there was a piece of steel that, like, it was like 9'2" or something like that. Hunter, being the smart ass that he is, he's like, oh, I got hops. He's like, I can jump up and grab that straight vertical.
Is his hops like the Capron phone book?
Pretty close.
You know, that's what mine
pretty
are.
Pretty close. And of course, he did it, so then I was guilted into it. I'm like, I'll give it a shot. Yeah, no.
No,
I don't think I could even touch the net on a basketball hoop.
I used to could.
Used to could.
Long time ago.
Used to could. I like it.
About 70 pounds ago.
Yeah, right? I think that's what most of it is, too. Hell. You start to get a little older, that shit packs on fast, too. Even at 25,
and,
man.
You know, things start to hurt worse. I mean,
I
you know.
Get this.
Go ahead.
I golfed last night at indoor league.
Oh, indoor.
I woke up this morning. It felt like I was put in a blender. Dude, I still, my whole core and everything, oh, my God.
Dude, you're only 25.
I know.
Just
I know.
Wait.
I know.
So, at work, we've been tree mulching, branch mulching, a bunch of shit in the area.
Yep.
And I stepped in a hole on Tuesday. My knee is still swelling up.
No kidding.
You know?
Yeah. That's
all I did was step in a goddamn hole. I'm like, ow, that hurt.
Yeah.
Ah, it'll be fine. You know? Friggin' Wednesday morning I woke up and it was like
softball on your kneecap.
Hello.
Yeah. Yeah. It's it'll be great. I'm sure, you know, when I'm knocking on 30's door, I'm gonna feel it.
Yeah. You got kids to keep you young. At least that's what I'm told.
I think they're part of the reason that I'm getting old.
Well, I'm sure most parents will say that.
Yeah. No, it's crazy, though, man. It, like we were talking earlier, you don't realize how fast time flies until you're in that position. Looking at my oldest, I'm still looking at him like he's 2-3 years old. He's 5 years old. You know, my youngest is 7 months old already, and it feels like yesterday we were in the hospital, and he's Cinco de Mayo, baby, so tacos every year for birthday party.
Heck yeah.
Hell yeah, I love it.
And Modelo's.
So, yeah, it's wild, though. I mean, it going through school and everything else, it was, oh, you know, I want to just grow up and this and that. And now it's like, dude, where's the time
Slow
going?
Slow it down.
Yeah, where's the time going?
Yeah. I'm getting friggin' old now, you know?
It's December. It's just, it was just June, like 3 days ago. It was June. Yeah. So
yeah, the sun was shining. It was 80 degrees. It was beautiful.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Take me back to that.
Now it's December. Like we were saying, 3 weeks from Christmas, 2 weeks from Christmas.
Well, I mean, look at another way, too. You know, we're in the middle of hunting season.
Yep.
Any luck to your hunting?
October 2nd, I shot a doe.
Nice.
It was.
I think I did see
it was
that.
In between a bunny rabbit and a doe. It was on the smaller side, but I had just
picked her up like this.
I could have over the shoulders and carried it out, yeah. But I had just on, I want to say it was like the last week of September, just ran out of venison. I'm like, I'm going to go sit early in a spot that I don't really care about a whole lot. And as soon as anything walks out, yeah. So the first, I didn't make it out on opening day because we had Willie's birthday party. So I went out the following afternoon, October 2nd. And I'm sitting there. There was a couple of deer moving, you know, in the neighboring fields and behind me and whatnot. And I'm sitting there, and it was probably an hour before dark. And all of a sudden, right under my stand, where I least expected a doe to come from, she walked right under my stand and right out into the field. She got about 15 yards out and clear shot, and that was it. And so
now you got some venison.
I got some venison. We made some brats because I do all my own processing.
Okay.
So. Cut them all up, steaks, roasts, you know, everything. I made, probably a month ago, I made 5 pounds of jerky.
Cool.
It turned out good. I did it on the smoker. Normally, I use a dehydrator. But,
what kind of smoker do you have?
Pit Boss.
Okay.
I love it. Love it. So I made.
I got a Traeger.
Oh, yeah, that'd be nice. Those are really nice. I like those a lot.
You know, I bought it at my birthday.
Mm-hmm.
I've been wanting a smoker for like 2 years. And every time I went to go buy one, I felt guilty because I'm like, God, I could buy this charcoal here for $189, and I'm that's good to go, you know. And I kept feeling guilty. And then this birthday, I was like, nope,
I'm doing it.
I'm mm-hmm. doing it, you know. So I bought it. I'm still learning to cook on it. But
is it the pellet grill or is it an actual?
Yeah,
it's a pellet
grill. No, it's a pellet grill.
Dude, I will never, ever, ever touch propane or charcoal again in my life. Once you get those figured out, you can do everything. I made the best thing to try, frozen pizzas on them.
Really?
You put a frozen pizza on there at like 300 or 350 degrees for about 25, 30 minutes. I am not kidding you. It is.
Dude, I got frozen pizza in that freezer behind you.
It is to die for, man. It is so good. That's the only way they cook them anymore. I got one of those little indoor rotisserie pizza cookers. I use that for the kids. If I'm eating a frozen pizza or if, you know, I make one for back and myself, it goes on the smoker.
No kidding.
Yeah, dead serious. It's awesome.
Oh, I gotta have to try that.
Yeah, it's awesome. Like I said, like 300 or 350 degrees for normally it's 20 minutes. With it being colder out now, it might be a little
Probably a little longer.
But oh, they turn out so, because like the top, the cheese on top is what picks up the smoke that comes off of the pellets. So the cheese turns like this dark golden brown, and it's absolutely beautiful when it's done cooking. And you go
and
to
probably
cut it, it's nice and crispy, and it's get, oh my God, I'm getting hungry thinking about it. I need another pork chop.
Another pork chop will work. I've never tried a pizza.
Yeah,
we cooked really a roast last weekend, and it turned out pretty well. You know, it was still juicy. It was a pork roast.
Yeah,
and it was still juicy. So I'm getting the hang of it. You know, but I just know you got to keep cooking. You got to keep experimenting.
I love
to get
it.
Better at it.
I love
you know?
It. I learned a lot of. Basically, the tricks and the way that I cook a lot of stuff I learned from my grandpa. And, I mean, he's Polish-German descent, so anything he makes is just...
Whatever you want to cook.
So it was funny when Beck and I got together, you know. I'd get home from work. She'd be like, what are we doing for dinner? I don't know. What do we got? She's like, oh, we got nothing. I'm like, yeah, right. So I'd go and I'd rummage through the fridge and rummage through the pantry and whatnot, and I'd cook up... You know, homemade. My favorite to make is homemade jambalaya because it's so easy. You get, you know, your Italian sausage or your Cajun sausage or whatever, and some rice and some corn and some, you know, whatever you want to throw in it, beans. Throw it all together, let it cook. I pull it off, and she's like, "How'd you learn how to make this?" I'm like, "I didn't learn. I just know that we had stuff, and I can put it together, and it'll probably taste good." But that's how I don't have recipes for anything. I never make the same meal twice because I don't have recipes for anything. I just look at what we have. Look at what I've got for dry goods. Look at what I got for meats or proteins or anything like that, and just throw it together. And if it's good, it's good. If not, Roses is 5 minutes away.
That's true. I'm not that lucky. I learn everything, basically. Like, my mom's a hell of a cook.
Mm-hmm.
But she never forced us to cook with her.
Right.
So, you know, when I was out on my own, I'm like, frozen pizza or cereal or
chicken nuggets.
Stuff.
Yeah, throw them in the microwave.
It's funny because I just had chicken strips before you got here.
It's perfect.
But, you know, I'm learning how to do all this, you know, basically on my own. So it's trial and error.
Yeah.
And I've made a roast that was not good.
Oh, and that's the thing, too. Anytime you go to make anything when you're cooking it, you're going to make 10 things that aren't good, but you'll make one thing that's good one time and you'll figure it out. That's it.
And you remember.
And then you build off of that. You know, say you start with just a roast. Well, you could step that up. Now say, you know, your ribs aren't going to be as meaty, so they're going to take a little bit less time to cook. You want to cook them a little lower. But you know what consistency you're looking for and how your grill runs and the hot spots and, you know, everything else. As soon as you get, like, the basics of it down,
it becomes easier.
Oh, it goes up from there. I can make – last year I think I made, like, 4 different batches of chili. And oh my Lord, the first one, not good. By the fourth one, it was phenomenal.
No kidding.
It was phenomenal. Yeah, absolutely. It was great. So
that's awesome.
But yeah, going back to, and this all stemmed from processing deer. But yeah, we, you know, I make all my own jerky and breakfast sausage and, you know, hamburger and steaks and roasts.
So do you like cut it up that night or the next day? Hang it up, let it drain out.
Yeah, if it's warm, like early season, we'll pretty much quarter them out or we'll bone them out that night, and then we'll put them in the fridge overnight or for a couple days, you know, and then we get to it. This time of year, what I like to do is let them hang for, you know, 3-4 days, something like that, and then cut them up from there.
Because it's cold.
Correct. Correct. So you don't need to hang them in a fridge or a freezer or nothing, because I mean, you got your fridge or freezer outside, thanks to living in the Midwest. But no, it's I enjoy. I actually, like, I'll tell anyone. I tell anyone. I enjoy everything after the hunt more than actually hunting itself. More.
Well, that's cool.
Yeah, because, I mean, it's I've got the grinders and the slicers and the scales and this and that. But anyway, going back to where we were.
I can already see it now. John B's processing.
Not me. not me. I don't. So I tried doing something like that once. I tried turning a hobby into a career, and it ruined it. It ruined it.
That's what I hear.
I honestly, I haven't probably touched anything to do with it in 3 or 4 years now, but I was really good with leather work. So making anything out of like holsters, wallets, belts, you know, bracelets, anything.
Try to turn that into a business, and all of a sudden you have to do it.
I did, and I was getting orders, and I had to do it. And I was making these custom hatchets that were really cool. I mean, they were like a traditional, because I have some Cherokee in me, and like, you know, going back to that, you get the traditional feel off of these hatchets, and with the leather work and the tooling and the everything on them, they were gorgeous. But you know, I'd get 3 or 4 orders for those. Now I've got 8 to 10 nights after work that I can't do anything I want to do because I got to get these done and get them out. And that's it. I walked away. I'm like, I can't do it. So for me, for buddies, for, you know, say,
yeah, you know,
Hunter shoots a deer. He's like, hey, right, let's cut this thing up. Let's process it. All right, cool. I'm down.
Well, I mean, he's helped you in the past. I mean, that's what friends are for. You know, you guys help each other out. Yeah. It's no big deal, yep, you know.
And we work together, so that helps too. Pretty much every day. Pretty much every day. He'll be on different job sites once in a while, but pretty much every day he's with me.
And that's funny because it's like most people that work together aren't friends outside of work.
Right.
And friends that are outside of work don't work together because it's too much.
There's too much butting
like
heads.
But you guys are like brothers, it seems
basically,
like. You know,
yeah.
So it doesn't matter
yeah.
at that point.
Yeah, and he knows there's a pecking order.
So but, you're on the bottom?
Yeah, me. Yes, all the time. But, no, I think the best part about it, though, is with him getting into the same thing that I do and going through the apprenticeship, and he's been in my shoes. I've been in his shoes. He doesn't want to run work. He doesn't want to be a foreman. I want to run work. I am, you know, I am a foreman. I wanted to be a foreman. It works out. It's a very cohesive relationship when it comes to work that we have. Like, it's basically, it's not like an oil and water. It's like water and water. You know, I mean,
work
together perfect.
Exactly. If you guys work together well,
yeah,
what's the matter at that point?
Yeah, absolutely.
Then it's not really work.
And it's to the point, honestly, we've been working together for almost 5 years now. It's like that idiom, the right hand knows what the left hand's doing.
Yeah.
That's
hey, I was thinking, nope, I'm already there. I'm doing it.
What?
That's what I'm saying.
Like, oh, yeah.
You,
oh,
the
yeah,
hunter.
Yeah, you
know,
oh, yeah, 100%.
Like, hey, I'm thinking maybe we ought to do it this way. And no, yeah, I've
already got it cut to do it that way. Like, all right, cool.
Exactly. So, that's cool when you guys are on the same page all the time.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely. Absolutely. It makes it easy. That's what it is. It makes it easy. Because I've worked with a lot of guys that I don't get along with and I don't work well with, and it makes it rough. It makes your days miserable, you know?
Yeah, it can make work not as much fun as it should be.
Yeah.
You know, I've been the same way. I mean, I've been lucky enough to have, you know, a few different jobs in my life. And in the bigger companies, you got your coworkers you really like. So you can, you know,
yeah,
they'll help you out. You'll help them out. Yep. And, you know, you respect each other, blah, 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 blah. But then you get into, like, smaller businesses. And all of a sudden it's like, oh, man, I don't really have a lot to choose from.
Right.
You know, and I don't really like them, mm-hmm, but I got to respect them because I need their help.
Right.
So.
And it sucks. You know, I mean,
you got to bite your tongue.
Yeah, pretty much. And that's the thing, too, is like working with someone that you get along with like that, even the worst day that you have at work can still be enjoyable at points because of the fact that, I mean, you're sitting there, you're fucking around, you're joking, you're laughing back and forth. And
you're there with your brother.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it makes life easy for sure.
So you and Hunter are coyote hunting this winter then?
Yes. Yeah, we started last year. It was in, I want to say, the end of January. Middle end of January, we finally pulled the trigger and bought thermal.
Ooh.
So we got thermal.
Thermal?
Yeah, so we got thermal set up on our coyote rifles.
Just for our viewers, it's not cheap.
Yeah.
But
it's cool.
Awesome.
It's cool. It's cool. And, I mean, the stuff that we got, we didn't go balls out right out of the gate. They had a great deal going at the company that we used to buy from. And basically, for just the price of the scope alone, You got the scope. You got the tripod. You got extra batteries and the whole nine yards.
So they threw a little extra to incentivize you to buy
it. They threw their tripod alone to set the rifle on. Basically, it's got a big vise on it, and you set it up, set the rifle in it, and it steadies you when you're out there scanning.
Now, is that a 360 then?
Yeah, it's got cool. A ball head swivel on it so you can spin all the way around, and their tripod alone was $400.
Ooh.
If you go on their website just to buy that tripod, it's $400. And then the rechargeable batteries and the charger is like an extra $120. So they gave us the scope, the tripod, and the batteries for just the price of the scope.
Nice.
So it's one of those ones that you can't really just walk away from. You know,
well, and, you know, if you guys are going to start getting into coyote hunting in the wintertime and things like that, you need to make that investment. It's no different than this podcast.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, I mean, these mics weren't cheap.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, this computer wasn't cheap.
Yeah.
But it's something I was like, I'm going to experiment with this for a long time.
Yeah.
You know, at least that's my goal.
It's yeah.
So I might as well make the initial investment, because once you make the initial investment, every time you use it after that,
It's paying for itself.
So if you make that initial investment on the thermal and everything else, theoretically, it's going to help you out down the road.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's the thing, too. It's like I started off with night vision last year, just regular infrared digital night vision. And I saw a lot of coyotes. I killed a coyote, actually the biggest one that I've ever killed, at 275 yards with it in pitch black.
Using what?
Night vision.
For a rifle.
Just an AR. AR-15. Yeah. Just 223. Nothing special.
That's a poke.
275. I was holding at his eyes, basically cross level with his eyes over center mass. He was standing sideways, standing broadside. And on a whim and a prayer, I pulled the trigger, and he just, what was that?
Winning.
Yeah, it was cool. It was really good. That's the first coyote that any of us in our little group have ever killed at night. So I was pretty proud of that. That was neat.
Heck yeah.
And then Hunter's like, I'm going to get thermal. I'm like, whatever, dude. So he ended up jumping and buying thermal, and I looked through his thermal once.
You had to have it.
I'm in danger. It was bad. So...
honey,
yeah,
I'm gonna do something real stupid.
Do something dumb
or real smart.
Yeah. So we, you know, we both ended up with the thermal, and then Coda bought thermal, and then Dan bought thermal, and now a lot of people have thermal. I mean, between you know, Bilski and Pat Wolf and all these guys, they've all got it now. So it's like it's fun because that group of guys that we talk to and that we, you know, hunt occasionally, we'll go out and hunt side by side with them and everything else. It's fun to be able to do all this together. And with Galen having the night vision, I mean, we've gone out a few times with him, and it's a blast. It's the camaraderie of it is just awesome. You know, I mean, it's such a good time. So
plus, you know, for people that have never hunt coyotes, they are smart.
Oh my god,
they are so smart.
Not that they're, well, I guess I can't put them, they're in a 100% different bracket than deer, but when it comes to how cunning they are,
oh, they're
brilliant. I would say that, you know, as far as hunting them goes, it's easy because you start the call. You know, sometimes they come running into the call.
Well, if you can reach out and poke them,
if you can't reach
out and poke them, it becomes awfully interesting at that point.
Yeah, and the trick is we like getting them into that, you know, between 75 to 125 yard range,
which is not far.
No,
realistically,
and getting them to that, unless everything is perfect, oh, it's impossible. I mean, yeah, with deer, if you're bow hunting, you got to get them within 30, 40 yards or whatever and whatnot. But the thing that I like about predator hunting is like my favorite hunting at all. And the reason that I like it is with deer hunting, you're sitting in a blind. You're sitting in a stand. You're sitting the whole time. Coyote hunting, you're at the same spot for 20, 30, maybe 40 minutes, but you're scanning with the rifle. You know, you're moving, you're messing with the call, getting the call, doing different things, checking back and forth. And if there's no coyotes there, you pack
you
up.
Move.
You move. You go to the next spot. It's awesome, man. It's fun. For sure.
That's awesome. So what are you going to do with it all?
I mean,
the whole adventures of coyote hunting and, you know, you got anything specific in mind?
Yeah. May or may not be working on a YouTube channel.
Yeah?
Yeah. I think I'm going to start one.
start a YouTube channel, or you're thinking of starting it.
I'm going to start it. I'm in the works of starting it right now. I've got a logo made. I've got an intro video made. I've got the name of it down.
And the name of this YouTube channel is
Cut Down Outdoors. And that's based off of Johnny Cash's song, God's Gonna Cut You Down. Because the coyotes, they get cut down.
You can run on for a long time. Run on for a long time. Run on for a long time. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down.
So I figured it was perfect. Kind of go hand in hand. Throw Cut Down Outdoors out there. And, you know, no one else has the name yet. And
cool.
To hell with it. You know, something just to kind of toy around with. And
you know, it's something to do in the pastimes. And it keeps you busy. It keeps you out of trouble.
It keeps you out of trouble. That's mm-hmm. the best part.
And then, you know, the cool thing, like in your situation, your kids probably aren't old enough to remember you now going out coyote hunting stuff, mm-hmm. but in 10 years they can always go to your YouTube channel, look it up, and be like, hey,
that's my dad.
This is dad.
Yeah, that's my
dad.
That
was a hell of a shot.
Yeah,
you know.
Yep.
So that'll be cool down the road.
Yeah,
for your kids to see.
Absolutely. You know? Absolutely. And like I said,
and if YouTube's still there in say 30 years, maybe grandkids.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe. You never know, man.
Yeah.
I mean, chances are high.
Pushing that out there. What do you say we wrap this thing up? I've had a great time.
It's been a blast.
With you.
Dude, this is fun. This is a good
time. We'll have to do this again.
Absolutely.
You know, absolutely. And we'll go from there.
We'll have plenty of more stories. They're coming in.
Oh, there's always stories
day.
To tell.
Every day we're getting stories.
Thanks for coming, John.
Yeah, thanks for having me.